gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to the Wednesday Week, the Chef Your Wednesday podcast. It's an absolute pleasure to be with you, and obviously, my name is Lord Hillsborough. And with us on the line today, we've got Fudge's here. Hello there, Fudge.
How's it going? I'm back from the exotic climes of Hillsborough, the exotic climes of Benidorm. So I'm still rotting. I'm not lying to you, but good evening, Lord H. How's it going? You all right? All right, chaps.
All the better for hearing you, old boy. All the better for hearing you. And, of course, Beastie's on the line with us. Hello there, Beastie.
That's Championship Beastie, if you don't mind. Championship Beastie is really looking forward to this now. I hope you're fully recovered and raring to go now, Fudgy.
Yeah, I'm on it. I'm on it.
And, of course, where would we be without Eddie from over there at Wednesday? Hello there, Eddie.
How are you doing, gents? Are you all right? Well, for my part, I've spent the last week in Bristol, which means that I'm starting a summer of scoping out all of the new locations that we're going to be heading for in the Championship. So Bristol was lovely. Didn't see the ground, but the beer were good. So crack on.
I went to Bristol actually last season. Went to go and watch Bristol versus West Ham randomly. One of my friends is a Bristol City fan. And Ashton Gate's a nice little turnout. But you can't like lager. It's got to be cider.
That's right down there, boys. That's right down there.
Back in again. Martin Chapman. Arteta. Shot. Yes, the equaliser. Carl Shot. 3 minutes after going behind, Sheffield Wednesday on level. What a reply. It was instant.
Wednesday News.
The main news I'd say to come out of Hillsborough this week would be the retention list. We've had some players released, and hopefully there's some players offered some new contracts and whatnot. So we'll start with that, shall we, gentlemen? So the players released. Obviously, there's Mr. Zomlebor and one or two more. I mean, Beastie over there. Any surprises for your boy? Beastie?
I'm here.
You're overcome with emotion because Clinton's gone, is that it? You had to compose yourself.
Don't even go there, right?
Oh, well, Beastie, we must say we've had a gentleman on Twitter, Mr. Lee Brown, who had on last week, who has been asking, how have you been coping with the news that Clinton will be leaving us?
I refuse to answer that question because he's not leaving us. Right, move on. Go on to the other players.
It's the first stage. Denial is the first stage, isn't it? And then anger, and then acceptance, and then just crying, I think. I don't know that.
Yeah. Look, I've spent many a moment...
Is that Clinton?
That's Clinton.
Clinton on the phone now?
Hang on a minute.
I ain't even leaving, bruv. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, what is it? Yeah? I'm like, not even going nowhere, mate.
Clinton. Is that you, Clinton? I can't believe you've resorted to selling PPI.
No.
It's too much.
How the mighty have fallen.
Oh. Well, it's coming to the back end of his career. He's probably squandered it away on women and champagne. He needs to earn his money somehow. Do you know what I mean?
Well, let's put it this way. If ever I'm going to buy PPI, Clinton's the man to sell it to me. do you actually buy PPI?
I think they're trying to give it you back, old boy. But
right.
They'll be having a hefty percentage off the top.
So go on then, Beast. What about it? The Semyon, the... Richard O'Donnell, what do you think, Beast? What do you think?
Well, I mean, you've got Semi going, you've got Sedgy going, and I've enjoyed watching both players. Sedgy's loved being at this club. He's a lifelong Wednesday fan, and for somebody like him to score goals for his boyhood club, it's the dream that all of us share, and he's actually lived it. Semi too. I've loved Semi. Who don't love Semi? At my age, Semi is as good as it gets. But fair enough. I mean, fair enough, he's been injury prone as lad. But when he's been on, I think he's done all right. I think both of them leaving, I don't think they deserve any vitriolic comments from Wednesday fans. I think we should just wish them well and thank them for what they did.
I think you're dead right. I think you're dead right. I don't think they've particularly played bad, but I think the level of football we're at now, I just think they were players that just didn't fit into the mould. I think Dave Jones has said it quite well. He's looking now to sign the players we've had on loan, I believe. I think that was a news article that came out in the last couple of days. And his main point was said, we've had a good camaraderie around the team, and I don't want to ruin it by bringing in players who don't know it. So he's looking at players like Ranger, Bart, and Antonio to try and make sure he keeps that camaraderie going. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. You know what? The only exception to that list, and I understand Sedgwick and Morrison, they're in the twilight of their careers. At Semibor, he's a decent player, but he probably can't make that step up. Richard O'Donnell, with him going, he's still a young guy. Do we think that Dave Jones has had enough of a look at him to think, well, look, he's never going to make it as a top-level goalkeeper? Because everywhere he's gone, he's done a job, and he got rave reviews in his loan spells this season. So do we think that maybe it's been a bit too soon for him, or do we not think that he has that quality deep down?
Well, I must admit, this was the one I was most disappointed with, chaps. The fellow's done a wonderful job, in my opinion. Of course, he made quite a lot of appearances, considering he was third string. I believe it's 8 appearances in the league, appearance in the FA Cup, an appearance in the Carling Cup, and saved his bacon on a few times, if I remember, chaps. Looked like a decent keeper to me. Obviously, we've left with, I believe Mr. Bywater will be offered a new contract, do you think? And obviously Mr. Weaver. And the young lad, Jameson, is that young lad's name? He's still there as well. So a bit of a loss for me, chaps. Bit of a loss for me.
I think it's a shame when any Sheffield Wednesday fan doesn't get a nod from the club and they have to reluctantly let them down. But it's heart-ruling head for me on that one. I don't think he set the world alight when he stepped into the fold. But if it was down between him and Jameson, I'd have given Jameson the nudge, for lack of a better term. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm with you on that, Fudge. I love Rich O'Donnell. You see his youthful exuberance when he has played for us, and he absolutely loves it. But we've really got to make some tough decisions here. Fortunately, it's Dave Jones making them and not us. And if we are going to improve and make headroads into Championship, unfortunately, people like Rich O'Donnell are going to be cast aside. Hopefully he can go away, learn his trade and come back and join us later when he's bigger and better.
Absolutely agree, Beastie. And, you know, I think this retain list or, you know, release list, combined with Dave Jones going public and saying he's offering contracts to Antonio, to Bart, to Niall Ranger, I think he knows that squad that has gone up with the camaraderie, with the team spirit, is a real good base starting point for this league. I don't think anyone's under any illusion that squad is good enough to compete in the Championship and survive in the Championship. You add 3 or 4 or 5 really good players to that mix and you're going to get a team that is going to be where we need to be, which is challenging at the top end of the Championship. So it's a real statement of intent this week, and it's something that I'm looking forward to over the summer to see where Dave Jones is going with those targets.
Absolutely.
We're talking earlier about camaraderie and something like that. Do you think that, like I said, we're after players that will fit in with the mould and know the banter and that sort of stuff, but do you think Niall Ranger fits in with that, or is everybody over the moon with Dave Jones shooting for Niall Ranger? It's something that I brought up in the past, and for me, I think there are better strikers out there that we'd end up paying for Niall Ranger. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, Niall Ranger is obviously a topic that seems to pop up on this show a lot, chaps. He's a bit of an odd one, isn't he? I mean, I must say he did play rather well the Wickham game, the last game of the season. But it's the first time I've really seen him shine. He is, of course, allegedly a Premiership striker. Again, Beastie, what's your thoughts on him?
I think what we have to do from the start of next season is whoever Dave Jones brings in, we have to trust his judgment more than anything. Now, fair enough, fans are indifferent about Niall Ranger, but maybe, just maybe, he's starting to gather a little bit of impetus to his game, and by next season, a few games in, maybe we will start to see the real Niall Ranger that Newcastle thought they'd got, that Dave Jones thinks I can make something out of this lad.
Yeah, you're right, Beastie. Yeah. You never know. A running in any team, in somebody's team, might give him a bit of confidence and change his attitude on life. Because at the minute, I can imagine him sat on the bench at. I don't even know if he sat on the bench. Sat in the reserve teams at Newcastle might give him that chip on the shoulder. Because I'm not a fan of his attitude, to be fair. But like I say, a run in a team might help him out. Might do some favours.
Yeah, I mean, if anybody's going to sort out that sort of attitude, I think Mr. Jones is the chap to do it. We've got a few, it was a polite way to put this, footballers, shall we say, in the Wednesday squad. And of course, it's also from the 18s chaps, the young gentleman that won Academy Player of the Year. He's been offered a professional contract, Mr. Jared Kyle, the young Australian chap. So he's definitely one to look out for. I mean, Eddie, there's been a few let go from down there. A gentleman that we were talking about just the other week, Mr. Tom Rowbotham, and Matt Tumley. I believe we saw him in a cup game. I believe he came on, a young right back, if I remember correctly. Any surprises down there, old boy?
Well, I think we've become accustomed over the last 5 years to the club saying, okay, we're going to give these final year scholars, probably the best five or six, we're going to give them that first year contract, because realistically, they are the best bet that we've got to unearth in another Tommy Spur, another Mark Beavers, something like that, that could really be valuable to the club. I think this represents a real sea change, because we're now in a position to actually compete and pay fees for players. So we have to be maybe a little bit more cutthroat when it comes to the academy. I'm actually quite surprised that Tom Rowbotham in particular didn't make it. I think Matty Tumulty, he was a little bit lightweight maybe at the age that he was when he came on in first team football.
He only looked 12 years old when he came
exactly,
on the team.
Exactly. So I think historically we've been in a position where we haven't had the weight of numbers in the first team squad, and neither have we had the prospect of bolstering the first team squad with paid signings to prevent these lads from getting at least a 1 year contract. I think this time round, given where the academy is, I think it's a statement of intent for the summer to say, look, we're going to be building the first team squad from outside the four walls of Hillsborough, and then the stated intention for Sean McCauley is to get that academy Division 2 status or whatever it's called, that are going to mean that Wednesday is going to be competing on an even keel at youth team level with the likes of Leeds, with the likes of Derby and Forest and those local teams that otherwise we're going to be losing players to.
Oh, absolutely. Again, chaps, as you said there, Eddie, the force of Milan that we've got behind us now. I mean, now we've popped up to the Championship. Fudge, do you think we're going to see Milan splashing the cash? Or do you think, of course, he's always made it clear that this is an investment. Clearly, he does feel something for the club. But he's always made it clear this is an investment. And do you think we're going to see some big money spent?
Well, I've got mixed feelings on this, Lord H, because this is exciting for me. I've supported Sheffield Wednesday now for the best part of 20 years, and very rarely have I looked on a summer that we're about to embark on, and we've got some money to spend, and we're going to be signing players left, right, and centre. It's mental. I've not known this in years. Do you know what I mean? And like, we're going to be signing decent players as opposed to people like, who was that clown that Atkinson brought in? Instead of players like Christian Merileb, we might be looking at other players like Paolo Di Canio again. Do you know what I mean? Obviously, not Paolo Di Canio's, but in that same mould.
Danny Sonner.
Danny Sonner. Oh God. The dark days, then, weren't they? They were dark days. But this excites me. But my concern is with Milan is that I've read too many articles, and I don't know. Am I reading between the lines on it or anything like that? But there always seems to be a mention where he goes, I nearly walked away, or if anybody. And do you remember when we were linked with that stripper who was going to buy us from Milan?
Yes,
Lee Strafford.
That was there was a stripper in the States who's looked at our club and thought, yeah, I'll have a go at that. And but Milan never went.
Milan never looked at her and said the same thing.
Milan Milan never said, it's not for sale, what are you doing, sod off. He just went, well, if she knows what she's doing and she comes in with the right offer. I just always think that he's always looking to shed us, but making a profit. Does that make sense to you? Does anybody else get that from him?
No, absolutely.
He's a tricky man to try and weigh up his Milan, isn't he? He's clearly his own man. And I do agree with you to a point. The first opportunity he's going to offload us. I honestly don't think he's going to offload us at a knockdown price and just get out for the sake of getting out. He's going to want to make some money. And I do, it might be me being naive, but I do think he has the best interests of the club at heart. It's not just a fire sale, right? I do think he wants this club to move on and do well when he leaves.
Yes.
And I hope that's what he wants.
You know what, Beastie? I absolutely agree with you there. I might be a bit of an old romantic. I might believe too much of the hype around Milan, and the way he talks is like a big cuddly teddy bear, and you just want to love him because he's part of our club now and he says all the right things about the fans. But there's no way, even as a hard-nosed businessman, that Milan Mandarić is going to waste 3, 4, 5 years of his life when he hasn't got much of his life left, let's be honest. He's not going to waste that time for a poxy 20 million or 30 million or 40 million pound profit. By all accounts, the Sunday Times Rich List came out, was it last weekend or the weekend before? He's already ahead of Kevin McCabe in that. He's in 100 of million pounds. Apparently, in the States, you can probably multiply that by 10 in terms of what dollars he has over there. So he's a very rich man. The idea, I think, for Milan Mandarić is to enjoy a real roller coaster ride with a club that can finally really compete at the top end of the top division when everything is aligned, when all them ducks are in a row. Sheffield Wednesday can be one of the top six, top eight clubs in the land. Now, if Milan Mandarić can go out with a real roller coaster ride and at the end he walks away with £100 million or £200 million, then it will be 5 years well spent. I can't imagine that he's going to want to go back to square one with £30 million in his back pocket and ferrying it around trying to buy Middlesbrough or someone like that. It ain't going to happen.
He's going to have a lot of change in it from 31 million if he buys Middlesbrough.
I wouldn't mind doing a spot of ferrying around with 30 odd million in my pocket, chaps.
It's a hell of a pocket.
Almost as big as Danny Barr's.
I just hope that with all the planning that we're making for the Championship, that we aren't just going to go on a spending spree and forget about the academy and forget about bringing young players through, because I really hope that we can bring some through for future.
No, I think what the way Eddie said it was right, because he said it was something to bring our academy up to scratch. So if we like, for instance, if the first team starts doing well, the club gets a bit more of a social standard in the country, then we will get the better young players and we will get a better academy. We will get better facilities. And I think success with the team, the academy will follow. And there's no reason why you can't be a top-end club. Like, if we're shooting at top eight, let's say, and be a top eight youth team. For example, look at Southampton and Wolves. They seem to and West Ham, they seem to produce some awesome players, and obviously you've got your Manchester Uniteds and your Manchester Cities. I think if the first team succeeds, I think the academy will follow. But like you said, Beastie, I think I don't want to leave the academy behind.
Sorry, Eddie, go on.
I don't want it to be a poor relation that we just stand and keep locked up like Sloth from the Goonies downstairs. Do you know what I mean?
Mission.
But you've also got clubs like, I'm not trying to compare us to them as regards wealth, but you've got clubs like Chelsea and Man City who have got wealthy owners. And you don't see young players coming through there, do you?
No, but it's a different setup for them, because I think what their point for that would be was to increase facilities and increase the training quality that the youth are going to get and then sell them. To a club like Manchester City, they're a commodity. They're they're something that's going to bring in a few quid every now and again. For example, Arsenal are fantastic at it. They seem to have a raft of players that they never tend to bring through, but they tend to sell on. For example, you've got what was that guy that went to Yeovil, Luke Eiling. You had that Carrera Gilbert that ended up messing his career up somehow. They, you know what I mean? There are a few. You have Emmanuel J. Thomas, who now plays at Ipswich. I think that's their thing. That's how they kind of fund themselves a bit. Do you know what I mean?
That's fair enough. Thinking back now, I think Ched Evans come through at Man City.
He did, yes.
Youth. Yeah, and so did Ishmael Miller, I think, didn't he?
Oh, we've been linked with him this week, have we not?
We have, yeah, we have. But the thing that I love, or I have loved over the last 10 years or so, a few years ago when we had a back line of Tommy Spur, Richard Wood, Mark Beavers, right, and all them three lads had grown up together. Now, all right, it didn't pan out how we all wanted it to pan out, but I took a great sense of pride in knowing that they were ours, that they were Sheffield Wednesday, that we'd created them.
Hey, too sentimental for me, Beastie. I'd rather have winners. I'd rather have people, even if there were a bunch of Geordies and Scousers, as long as they're kicking 10 bells of crap out of whoever's running towards them, I don't mind where they're from. But I do see what you mean.
I'm sure that from the past, we must have learnt his lesson, chap, surely. I mean, we splashed all that money out on Di Canio and the other Italian chap.
Benitez,
yeah, of course, and that what put us in this position in the first place, chaps.
Exactly that, Lord H. And I can hold you one shining example, which will slap you in the face, Fudge, that blows all that. Let's spend money and get decent players in to get us out. Get us where we want to be, and that is De Bild.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, but bear in mind as well, come on now, like, Gio De Bilder for me was a striker that came with some kind of pedigree. He wasn't by any means a poor player. It's just that because, and I think we got on his back, the main reason we got on his back is he was taking this quite large wage and we paid something like 3 million for him or something, haven't we, or 2.5 million. And he wasn't bleeding for the club. And I guess what you're saying is that if we had Sheffield players through the Sheffield ranks, they'd bleed for the club.
No, not necessarily that. Take somebody who is an average player, somebody like Peacock or Lee Bullen. They have a certain set of tools. They are never going to set the Championship or above alight. But what they did do is they performed every single week, 100%. They gave everything. And they represented our club to the best of their abilities. Whatever their abilities were, they represented it to the best of their abilities and gave everything. And De Bild never once, in my opinion, gave 100%. In fact, I can't remember him giving 50%.
I think that I agree with you to some extent, but I also think the club was in a bit of a shambles in terms of management at the time as well. And I think he must have thought to himself, Christ, who have I signed for here? What's going on here? This is mental. Do you know what I mean? I think that had something with it. And then when we start getting on his back, you know what we're like as fans? Jesus, we're awful.
Yeah, that's just a football fan for you, isn't it, boys?
Not me. I won't get on anybody's back.
No. You just give him a jolly good tonguing, old boy. A jolly good tonguing.
So are you telling me then, Beastie, at some point you've given Semi a tonguing?
Look, many's the time I've been on that terrace and thought they were pulling Semi off too soon.
Oh, dear old boy.
So what else have we got? We've got contracts offered to
before we go on to that next bit, can I just mention that the two people that we haven't mentioned who are leaving are Sean Cuff and Verdane Oliver. And I can't believe that nobody, it must just be me, but to me they sound like a pair of porn stars. Sean Cuff and Verdane Oliver. I'm sure that Sean Cuff played Emmanuel in Emmanuel 12.
I mean, Mr. Oliver seems to have been knocking about the place years. He seems to be one of those names that have always in the background. And I don't know about you chaps, I've never seen a thing of him.
No, because we've always had seven goalkeepers at the time. We seem to love goalkeepers at Sheffield Wednesday.
That's it, chaps. That's it. I mean, we've had a fair few. We've knocked a few decent chaps out before. Speaking of goalkeepers, Mr. Bywater, are we expecting him to have a new contract? Eddie, what do you think, old boy?
Oh, I'd certainly hope so. I mean, he's been a great goalkeeper. I honestly think, and there's people who say, oh, he hasn't had anything to do, that, you know, the back four have protected him, etc. I think he's organised that defence fantastically this season just gone. I think he's a championship keeper. And you know what? Even if he wasn't, even if he couldn't cut it, let's just keep him around the dressing room, because he's unbelievable for team morale. You know, if you follow him on Twitter, he's great for morale. For anyone who follows him on Twitter, he's brilliant. He turns up on any average day, he'll come out and he'll go, I've just bought 8 Wensleydale cheeses and I'm going to eat them all. You know, he's completely mental. So how can that not be a good thing for the dressing room? So yeah, keep him in here. I'd like to see him carry on progressing. I think he's a decent keeper. I think he can manage it at championship level. But if not, certainly he's a fantastic example as a professional without being too footballer professional. He's just a decent bloke. So let him stay, yeah.
Bit like Clinton, you mean?
Exactly like Clinton. Less gangster in some ways.
We could keep Clinton, but... then. Let's just keep Clinton. Just to keep everybody happy.
Eddie, he's gone. He's gone, Beast. Let it go. He's gone.
What about if I pay his wages?
I'll tell you what, mate. I don't think any of us earn enough money for that, mate. But yeah, I love Bywater. Like I said before, he's mad as a fish in petrol, and I think he's fantastic. And like you say on Twitter, he makes me laugh. I mean, what was that one? We said it before, where he said, "I've just bought 2 cans of semolina, but I've not got a spoon, and I've only got a toothbrush. So I'm going to eat it with a toothbrush." So he just uploaded photos of himself eating rice pudding with a toothbrush. I mean, what? He's mental. I love him. Absolutely love it, chaps. And this one's going to cause some kind of discussion. Mark Beaver's been offered a contract, yeah. Aaron Jameson, we spoke about that earlier on. Jermaine Johnson.
Oh, JJ. In my opinion, chaps, JJ is one of those fellows I want to love him so much. I really want him to be a hero, but when you see him walking about and you just want to give him a kick in the pants and say, "JJ, boy, move yourself," and I really want to love the chap, but he makes it so hard.
I've just talked about the idea of Bywater being, he's not a typical footballer, he's got a little bit of something else about him. I mean, insanity being that thing. JJ is like the prototype typical knobhead footballer. Everything he does basically is informed by the fact that he hasn't really got a clue about life. But any football club that bends over backwards for Gary Medin, offers a contract to Niall Range, but then says to JJ, "Actually, you're not really our sort, you're not mature enough." Well, we've got something wrong there, haven't we?
Yeah,
he's still got enough talent to cut it. It's down to the right manager. It's down to maybe a captain or a more veteran player settling him down and actually getting him to concentrate on his football. Because as he showed in the middle part of this season just gone, he's incredible on his day. He can win games single-handedly.
Absolutely, I wouldn't want us
to be saying, "No thanks, JJ," and him go off to someone else like Ipswich and then tear us a new asshole whenever it is that we play them.
Yeah. But the thing is, with JJ, he's like Medin. You've got to keep things simple. And you know, when they give him the instructions to come on pitch, it's just one arrow that says, "Run here for a bit," then run, then it changes direction 90 degrees, "Run that way for a bit." And somebody has to actually explain to him what the goals are and where they are. Everything has got to be laid out in very, very basic terms for him. The only thing he needs is one of the, you know, remember them, they probably still sell them, footballs on strings that you can tie to your boots on. It goes on a loop, doesn't it? That's what he needs, because the number of times that he's forgotten the ball, it just drives me insane.
How old is JJ now, chaps? Do we know?
29, 30, something like that. Hang on, no, he's...
No, he's older than that.
Me. No, he's 31.
He's not like Tony Yeboah, is he? He's not like 67, but claims that he's 32.
I don't know if you noticed, chaps, but whenever the Wednesdays are defending a corner, it's always JJ that's left out to pelt after the ball. Should it spring? It's never one of the strikers. It's always, I mean, at that age, if you've still got that sort of speed and oh, this JJ, I just want to love you so badly, but no, I can't.
I do like JJ when he's used correctly. Like you say, he is frustrating, but I can't think of a better player that we've got in our squad. And you've got to think to yourself whether we should carry a player like this, that we should have on the bench till about 70 minutes, 65 minutes, and go, right, go. Do you know what I mean? I think you use your substitutes. The reason anybody uses a substitute is to change a game. And I think whether it's to defend more, whether it's to attack better, whether it's hold the midfield, it's to change a game. And I don't think there's a player better than JJ to bring on towards the back end of a game and say, right, I see that fullback, tear him apart. And I think he will. It'll be like a caged animal coming off that bench.
I've got to disagree. If we're again, comes back to what I said before. If we're going into Championship, we need to step up on the quality of players that we're getting. And if we can't do better than JJ as a winger, then I think we're going to have problems. If he is going to get a contract, then it needs to be a rolling contract because he spends that much time on sick bench. That it's not worth our while giving him a long-term contract. Give him a rolling contract. And fair enough, bring him on for 10, 20 minutes.
Who was it at that turn? It was Megson when JJ went, he did like a touch and then he went clean through and then stuck it wide. And Megson went, well, yeah, JJ missed the chance, but nobody else but JJ would have got in that position to score.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you know what I mean? I think it was you, Lord H, that the tweet that sort of said, has anybody else noticed that the words almost and JJ are always in the same sentence?
Yeah.
Oh, but no, I mean, obviously, chaps, we've got Mr. Tracy. I mean, I believe we've been looking at keeping hold of Mr. Tracy as well. Again, he seems very handy, obviously not as quick as JJ, but that left foot, very handy indeed. And just looking at Twitter here, chaps, our very own news hound, Mr. Craig, has just tweeted out that Mr. Jones has confirmed that the Wednesdays are looking at a permanent deal for Antonio. But he wouldn't be too disappointed with another year-long loan. What do we think, chaps? Are we going to hang our hat on loan players again, boys? Or are we going to try and get these chaps in permanent? Beastie, what do you think about that, old boy?
This is why. If JJ is going to play a part, it's going to be a very, very small part. Because if we're getting the likes of Tracy and Antonio, which is the sort of quality that we should be looking at in Championship, we shouldn't be looking at anything less than that quality, right? Then players like JJ, we don't need them anymore. Tracy, to me, will only get better. He's carrying a little bit of extra weight. Yeah, I mean, this is me talking.
He is
carrying a little bit of extra weight, and you can see that he isn't at full fitness. But if we get him, I'm sure that Dave Jones will get him right back in the groove, and that he is going to be a great player. And on the other side, well, you don't need to build up Antonio, do you? What he's done this season speaks for itself.
He obviously wants to come to the club as well, Antonio. He seems very happy with the fans and the club and just playing that important role. Eddie, would you say it was essential, or obviously it was all a bit of an extra bump, wouldn't it, old boy? Do we need him?
I think this is probably the best advantage that we've got as Sheffield Wednesday going at the Championship right now, is that there is a buzz about the place. You know, the players are not going to come to Hillsborough and think, cool, you know, I'm in for a relegation battle. You know, I might come if the money's right, whatever. The likes of Keith Tracy and Mikhail Antonio absolutely have loved the last 3-4 months however long they've been here. That is a massive thing to a footballer, to feel at home, to feel part of something, and to feel that a club can bring their game on. Now, are we saying that Mikhail Antonio and Keith Tracy are players that can take us to the very top of the Championship, which is where we want to be? I don't know. Right now, based on the performances in League One, possibly not. But take some weight off Keith Tracy and give him that extra impetus of the crowd and a buzz in Hillsborough. He absolutely could be a top championship player. Mikel Antonio, he was a bit part player at Reading, but they were a top championship side. There is no reason why he couldn't be the cornerstone of a really successful championship squad. So, yeah, I think we should regard them, like Beastie said, as the baseline for where we want to be. We shouldn't be signing players that are any less than that. We should be looking at them and saying, okay, they're going to be the bread and butter of the squad, and it's going to be the players over the top of that that are going to really put us in a position to really compete.
I think you're dead right. I think Antonio, for me, he's not old by any stretch of the imagination, is he? And I think he's got a good few years getting better in front of him. That and he's got that Yaya Toure around him. You know, when he gets the ball at his feet and he just batters like a freight train down that pitch, you can't think, well, go on, stop him, I dare you. Do you know what I mean? I like that. He excites me.
It does seem to struggle towards the end of the game, chaps. I mean, again, I'm not one to speak, but the last maybe 15 minutes or so, it doesn't tend to run quite as hard. But I suppose the chap's only going to get better, boys. He's only a young lad. He's only going to get better.
Fingers crossed.
All right, then, chaps. So that's the retention list. Anybody else any more points on that?
Well, I just hope we have a summer of... I mean, bear in mind, we are going to get linked with everybody at this point, aren't we? I know that Nottingham Forest are trying to offload Ishmael Miller because of his wage bill. We're going to get linked with him. But I think Dave Jones is playing his cards quite close to his chest. He's not commenting on anything. Would anybody like to suggest any signings?
I've got a bit of breaking news that I don't think it's been on Twitter or on internet yet, but I've got a really good source.
Is this a Wednesday week exclusive?
It is, yeah, it is. But I've been told this morning that we're in the hunt for Patrick Kluivert.
Again?
Fantastic.
Oh, my Lord.
Keep your eyes peeled for him down at the ground having a medical.
I did wonder, a couple of days ago, I was walking along Penistone Road and a car went past. I didn't think anything of it, but it did have Patrick Kluivert drives a Yaris from Monty's written on the side.
There you go.
I don't know. It could just be a sign.
No, but seriously, any signings that you think are attainable or that you reckon we could have a shooter? For example, I don't think he'd come, but I think in terms of an attainable target, like that Gary Hooper that scored 5 goals for Celtic the other day, we're a big club. Why shouldn't we be sniffing at players like that? Do you know what I mean?
I really hate us going in for any striker north of border or any player north of border, because I've seen that Scottish Premier League up close and personal, and it is not good to watch. The players are of such a poor standard. I don't care whether they play for Celtic or Rangers and that they play in Europe, they are poor.
And you're going to get some mail, BC.
It's monkey tennis. At the end of the day, you've got strikers who play for Scunthorpe, who go up there and score 25, 30 a year. That's not a good league, and we shouldn't be looking at players from that league.
Exactly,
I must admit,
right,
chaps, I don't know, whenever I watch the Scottish chaps up there, when they score and they rip the shirts off, it's not exactly the rippling muscles that you see in the Premiership.
I noticed that. It was the other day on BBC. Somebody's got a new contract and he's running towards the camera with his shirt off. It looked like Beastie.
How very dare you!
The only thing they've got going for them up there is, especially the homegrown players, is they are as hard as chuff. Yeah, I mean, you've only got to look at Mark Reynolds. He got a tackle when he played for us last season in one of the cup games. And to anybody else, it were a red card. Right? But because he'd done it to Reynolds, Reynolds took it as foreplay. That's how hard they are. But as for footballing skills, they are just dreadful.
What about Cardiff players? Do you reckon we're going to be getting any of the old Cardiff guard? Do you reckon we're going to get linked with players like Mark Hudson, maybe Peter Whittingham? Or, do you know what I mean? Are we going to end up sniffing around them? Because I tell you what, how Cardiff keep getting to the playoffs and still manage to do it with a similar bunch of players and still manage to keep their enthusiasm up impresses me, because I can imagine... I've done it on Football Manager. I get to the playoffs, get knocked out, and I'm thinking, Christ, I've got to go through another bloody season. Do you know what I mean? And And the fact that Cardiff keep managing to do that impresses me. Are we going to get linked with Dave Jones's old team, do you think?
Well, I mean, we've seen what Dave Jones has been looking at with Mr. Ranger, obviously. Of course, chaps, in my opinion, that's the way we need to be looking. Fringe Premiership players, maybe, or established Championship players. We have got that money to spend. Hopefully, if Milan's whipping it out there. So, in my idea, we need to be looking that way on. I don't know what you chaps think.
Go on, Eddie.
For me, it's kind of one of these things where, do we want to go where other teams have failed? Do we want to look at the top six or top eight of the Championship and try and prune off some of their players who have already been there and thereabouts it, but haven't actually made it into the Premier League? Or do we look to poach from the league where we've just gone? Should we be looking at a Jordan Rhodes or a Chris Porter? sorry, I went mental for a minute then.
It's Eddie.
Oh, but in all seriousness, do we look to take the very best of the league that we've just come from, or do we look to the players at the top end of the Championship where we aspire to be, or do we really push the boat out and try and persuade a couple of players, proven Premiership names, to actually drop down a division? Because there's a project going on here. This isn't Sheffield Wednesday are out of League One and we're going to be happy in the Championship. The stated aim here from everyone at the club is, we need to be back in the Premier League. If we can persuade, one or two quality players, Premiership squad players who have some experience, to drop down a division, to drag this team kicking and screaming up into the Premier League where they belong, then fantastic.
Well, I mean, we've seen it before, chaps. Antonio, as an example, there obviously wasn't a Premiership player then, but the chaps that are on the fringes are squad players, if you like, of the, I mean, they come to the Wednesday and they get the fans behind them and they love it. They absolutely love it. And Sheffield Wednesday boys, I mean, it's a big name. It's not something to sniff at. Everybody knows the Wednesday.
I'd really hate for us to be going back, for Dave Jones to be going back to somewhere like Cardiff and bringing old strikers or old players that are at the wrong end. At the wrong end of the careers. I really won't want us to get somebody like Kenny Miller or Earnshaw. To me, we should be looking at the other striker that they've got, like Joe Mason, somebody like that. I know we won't get him from them, but they got him from Plymouth, and that's the sort of striker we want. We've got a couple of good lads there if we get Ranger and Medin. We need somebody that's got a little bit more pace about him, somebody like Joe Mason.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think we should be getting these Premiership quality fringe players. I think that's the best way to go. Or like you said, because bear in mind, you said that could we persuade somebody to come down, some established Premiership players to come down to the Championship in order to take us back up? I mean, we did it with a manager. Do you know what I mean? We got a Championship manager, an established Championship manager, to come down to League One. Why can't we do it with players from the Prem? Why not?
Exactly. We've done it with two managers, some may say, Mr. Megson and Mr. Jones. Obviously, these chaps are top-class guys, top-class gaffers. So then, chaps, is that it for the transfer list, gentlemen? Shall we crack on with a bit of a rumour that's been popping about?
I think after probably 45 minutes of talking about it, I think we should probably move on. Otherwise, this podcast is going to be feature length.
So then, chaps, the rumour mill has been turning, and it looks like Mr. Jones has been looking at Kieran Lee from over there at Oldham Athletic. A young lad, as far as I can see, plays left and right back. And I mean, do you think that's something Mr. Jones is looking at? We have had a little bit of a problem with left back while Reader's not been here. Fudge, we know your opinions on Mr. Buxton. So what do we think, chaps? Is this a player for the future that he's looking at, or somebody that's going to come in and bust straight into the squad? Eddie, what do you think, old boy?
It just says squad player or player with potential. I don't think he's looking and saying this is a solution to whatever issues we have at fullback. And personally, and I know you're going to disagree with me, Fudge, I don't think we have issues at fullback. I think in Reader Johnson and Lewis Buxton, we've got two fullbacks who can cut it at a higher level. So I see this as, again, the right sort of move for this time of the season. Let's get someone in, let's bolster the squad. He's been a consistent performer for Oldham, but let's see if he can step up. I know Dave Jones has been talking about this development squad. I think maybe if we're looking to pay fees for people, we aren't going to be bringing people into the development squad for that. But it's baby steps. It's a nice little move at the start of the season. But let's not worry about this. This ain't going to be the major transfer news of the summer. So
yeah, I mean, the chap looks like, I mean, he started his career off at Manchester United. Popped out onto QPR and then, From what I've been told, from the rumours popping about, he's been not just consistent, but Oldham's outstanding player. Fudge.
I'm on board with anybody coming in at fullback. Not because the reasons you probably think. I think anybody who will take Raider Johnson out of fullback, so Raider can play that defensive midfield role if we need to, I'm all on board for, because I think Raider, when he plays in front of the front four, at the back four, for me, he's a different player. And I like him there. Now,
you've
all right.
You've gone crazy!
I love it.
You've been
playing
too much Football Manager, mate. I played 2-1-3, 2-1-2.
Playing in the MC, he did it against West Ham. When we played West Ham in the Cup, I couldn't work out where Raider was playing. He was all over the place.
That's his game. That's the same for everybody. Nobody knows where he's playing.
Yeah, that's he's like a Scarlet Pimpernel on the pitch, is he? Is it? I tell you what, though, just before we go, I did Google Kieran Lee, because obviously, like most of us, we've never heard of him. Apparently, he was. This is what I found. He was originally born Sunit Patel, 1984, 28 years old, from Derby. And then I read, it said, Kieran Lee is a British pornographic actor, won the 2007 UK Adult Film and Television for Best Male Actor. He's East Indian and British by ethnicity. I thought, bloody hell, we've got a right player.
That's where Sean Cupp's gone then to make a film.
A little bit of eye candy for the ladies, chaps. A little bit of eye candy. Ladies and gents, we'll call that an end to this week's Wednesday News.
The ball into the middle lane for Hurst. Head! Absolutely brilliant. And David Hurst maintains his impressive scoring form here at Hillsborough.
So, ladies and gents, we're going with our Pull Down Your Chance section. This is our chance to expose ourselves to you and show us a bit of our talent. This week, again, we're rather light on suggestions from our listenership out there. So, you're stuck with one of ours again. So, this week, it's for Mr. Bywater, and it's to Bridge for Troubled Waters.
When you're one-on-one, feeling tall, when the goal's in your sights, and you think you've scored, then out he glides. No matter how you try, never beat Stevie Bywater. He will lay you out. He will lay you out.
Actually, the funniest thing I've ever heard. Yeah. Seriously, it's brilliant.
That is the Eurovision song entry by Engelbert Hillsbridink.
Engelbert Johnny Sheridanink.
Yeah. In all seriousness, look, this is a Sheffield Wednesday podcast. Lord Hillsborough, if you are a frustrated pop star, then can you not just take this to the X Factor or The Voice? Because we've got football to talk about, and that as much as you've got a lovely voice, and you have, you could sing at a wedding, you'd be fantastic, but that is embarrassing.
Well, that to me is one of them songs where I like listening to it, but there's no way on earth that's making it to the terraces, because if that goes to terraces, I fear for music everywhere. It will be the end of music.
Can you imagine? Can you imagine a lot of that 3,000 angry Yorkshiremen on the away support? Do you know what I mean? Going, like a Steven. I want the...
they couldn't pick an octave.
By water.
The cop, historically, the cop struggled with clap, 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 boom. So, you know, this is an entirely new kettle of fish.
Like,
so.
Like I said back in episode one, we struggle with... We've got Ryan Lowe, Ryan Lowe. I appreciate we've got technical over the last few years, but wow. Wow.
The Hey Jude always gets me cringing, because I always worry when it comes to the 2, 3, 4, and you can hear every Wednesday fan going 2, 3, and some of them even get the numbering wrong. So
yeah,
if they
some
can't
of us
get...
can't count to 2 or 3, to
exactly.
be fair.
Exactly. If they can't count that, they're going to struggle with this. As much as I love it, I've got to give it a thumbs down.
Sorry, from me as well, Lord H. It's a bin from me.
I don't want to crush a man's dreams, so I'm going to say a thumbs up, but for all the wrong reasons.
So then, ladies and gents, that brings us to an end for this week. It's been a rather different show, obviously, with us not having any games to review or preview or anything like that. But rest assured, we are working on a programme for you throughout the summer. You are a blogger or a chap or chapette that runs a notice board and things like that, please do get in touch with us. And hopefully, very, very soon, we'll be opening the Skype for everybody, so you can phone in and have a little bit of banter with us. So we'll call that for this week, ladies and gents. If you would like to contact us, you can get in contact with us, of course, at the usual outlets over there on Twitter, at TWWcast on Twitter. You can email us at TWWpodcast@gmail.com. And of course, we're over there on Facebook if you do a search for Wednesday Week, and over on our YouTube channel as well. Again, ladies and gents, we are ever so slightly creeping up the iTunes chart. I don't know if you've seen, gents, we've been on the new and notable, well, most of the time now, chaps. Have you seen that over there?
I think that means officially we've been downloaded 7 times. So, excellent.
Wow. Nice. I think me and my mum are two of them.
So yes, gents, please do, if you do use iTunes, please pop over there and give us a review of 5 stars, if at all possible. And if you do have the time just to write a little bit of something, that all goes towards popping us up the charts there, and it would be very, very much appreciated. Also, this week we did crack over 2,000 views on our YouTube channel, so fantastic, absolutely. And we've also broke 400 followers on Twitter, so we're getting massive, chaps. We're getting massive, slowly but surely. So, that's all that's left to say. Goodbye from Beastie by Beastie.
Goodbye. See you all soon.
And if people want to get hold of you, Beastie old boy, where can they get hold of you?
Yeah, they can get in touch with me on the Owls Alive website at owlsalive.com or on Twitter at Beastie_. And as usual, I'll talk to anybody.
Very good. And of course, I'm sure if you follow 10 or 15 metres behind Clinton Morrison's car, you'll see Beastie roundabout there as well. Fudge, if people want to get hold of you, old boy, where can we find you?
Get on Facebook. It's Fudge and Dave, the Unnamed Project, or at Fudge and Dave on Twitter. See you later, chaps. Thanks a lot.
Good old Fudge. Nice to have you back, old boy. And Eddie, where can people get hold of you, my old mate?
As usual, I'm on Twitter at Sausage Arms. I'm also on Facebook. I'm also on wanted posters around the North Yorkshire region. So tell your friends.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, of course, you want to get on me? You can get on me on Twitter at Lord H. That's L0RDH over there on
Twitter. Well, thank you ever so much for listening, ladies and gentlemen. We do hope you've enjoyed the show. We do hope you've enjoyed the show, and we shall see you again very soon.